to everyone who is within the sound of my voice, I feel like God is saying that there's been a spirit of stagnation that has been upon people. It's like spinning wheels. And I just want to break that thing off right now prophetically. I speak to you that delay and stagnation is broken. And you know, we always say this. In a moment we pass from the last year to the new year, and it's not a magic thing, you know. It's just you're moving from one moment to the other. And so every time God gives a word for any year, it doesn't end with December 31st and it doesn't start with January 1st. It's a word that God gives because God is always speaking, right? But it continues on. So any word that we heard in the last year, if I ask you for a show of hands, which I'm not going to ask, you know, you'll find that God is still continuing to do. It's not over. He has fulfilled some things and he's continuing to fulfill. And those things that we haven't seen manifested, we still need to cling on. Amen? So when I say, you know, we want to go there and we want to be in that place where no more delay and no more stagnation. We want to break the power of that thing off of us because we are going to be a people moving forward. All right. Now for the prophetic word, I have 4 points just like Brother Nirmal here. And I want to start off. And this is, I've been praying and brooding over this. I was fasting and seeking the Lord, not for a word, but, you know, just seeking him for who he is. And I heard the Lord clearly. And the first thing I want to say is God is releasing a spirit of Phineas. Okay, I don't know. Some people call it Phineas and I say Phineas, but you get it. In Numbers chapter 25, actually, there is a story of, and Phineas comes before that, but there is a story, and I'm just going to talk to you what I mean by the spirit of Phineas. Phineas, the name itself means oracle, all right? Now, Phineas was the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, okay? So he was just in the priestly line. But Numbers 25 talks about an incident where Israel had actually mingled with the Midianites and they had committed sin, and so God's wrath had come upon them because God had said, keep away from those that are not, you know, worshiping God. And so Phineas actually, and so it was a time of actually the whole nation of Israel was mourning because the judgment of God had come upon them, and 24,000 Israelites had been hit by the plague. The wrath of God had come and they had died. So at such a time, if you read Numbers 25, you'll find that everyone, including Moses, all of the elders and everyone was sitting and crying. They were weeping. So at a time of national weeping, a man called Phineas stood up. He was not a warrior. He was not a teacher. He was a priest. But he stood up and he took revenge. And so the story is that, you know, there were two people who were disobeying God and, you know, just openly defying God within the camp. One was an Israelite man and the other one was a Midianite woman. So it was a Jew and a Gentile. And what Phineas does is he goes and he takes revenge. The zeal of God so consumed him. I'm giving you the background to tell you what it means when I say that God is releasing the spirit of Phineas again in planet Earth, in Toronto, Canada, in the young people, in the old people, anyone who would position themselves. It was Phineas who, out of zeal for the honor of God's name, he rose up and he avenged these two. And God was so pleased with this that he stops the judgment, the plague that was happening. And then God speaks to Moses in Numbers 25 and says, look, this guy was zealous for my honor, for my name. And because of that zeal, I am going to give him. God was so pleased about it that God said, I am going to give him an everlasting blessing. So he speaks over him a covenant of peace. I want you to go home and study this, Numbers 25. And so what does that even mean? See, Phineas was moved by the zeal of God. And I declare to you that God is raising up a company of people who will be moved with the zeal of God, who would be moved for the honor of his name, who will be moved when everyone else is sitting and weeping and crying and mourning over what is happening in the nation. There will be a company of people that God would breathe the spirit of Phineas upon, that they would come and they would do what it takes. They would do what is necessary, that they would avert the disaster. There will be people who will be moved by the zeal of God. They won't just sit and watch. They'll do something about it. Now, the good thing about it is that Phineas, the story of Phineas doesn't end there. He continues on. Later we see that he leads Israel in battle. And we see that in chapter 31 of Numbers. And then we see again that, you know, he actually brings an oracle to the entire nation. Then later we see that he actually is a peacemaker between the tribe of Benjamin and the rest of the tribe of Israel. So he played many roles. Because of his zeal for the Lord, the nation itself looked up to him. Which priest leads a nation to battle? So I want to say roles are changing. You may think that you were called for just one thing, but God is changing it. When the spirit of Phinehas comes upon us, we will know how to lead people. We will know how to take action. We will move out of the position of weeping and mourning to do something about it. We will be moved with zeal for the Lord Almighty. Hallelujah. And we'll do something about it. Can I talk to you about the blessing? See, God had said, I'm so pleased with this that I'm going to give him an everlasting blessing. Imagine doing one thing for the zeal, for the honor of God's name, that he gets an everlasting blessing. And so you'll see, if you go down the genealogy, you can trust me on it. I've studied and looked at it carefully. In the lineage of Phinehas was Zadok, the priest. And about Zadok, it is said that when the rest of Israel went astray, Zadok and his sons followed the Lord. And therefore God said, I will cause you to stand before me in my presence and serve all the days. When the others stand far off, you will stand right in front of me and minister. That's found in Ezekiel 44. A generational blessing that came out of Phinehas' lineage. And then if you fast forward, you'll see Ezra. Ezra, again, was a social reformer. He was a teacher of the word. He was a preacher. He was, again, zealous for God. He comes in the scene from Babylon, from captivity. He comes along with other people. And Ezra, it says the hand of his God was upon him. Favor was upon him. So when I say that the spirit of Phinehas is upon us, that God is releasing this for this time. See, every time when the body of Christ is coming closer to the end, coming closer to the coming of Jesus, you know, there's special grace that is released. Every season brings in a new grace. And so I declare to you that the spirit of Phinehas is upon us so that we can inherit a blessing. It's upon us so that we can do things for the kingdom. It's upon us so that we can do multiple things. God is giving that enabling of grace. The spirit of Phinehas, we can teach. We can see, Phinehas not just entered the promised land, but he led people in the promised land. He was one of those who went through the wilderness. Because this happened in their wilderness journey. The story of when Phinehas in Numbers 25, when he intervened and pleased God, it happened in the wilderness. He not only survived the wilderness, he came out into the promised land and he led people in the promised land. Hallelujah. So we receive the spirit of Phinehas. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We will stop plagues and we will save lives and we will lead people and all of that, and we will inherit an everlasting covenant. It's a great blessing. Imagine our children's children and the next generations to come forever standing before the presence of the living God. Hallelujah. Because we dared to have the zeal of the Lord. Because we dared to move and take action. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. So this thing doesn't end here, you know. There is a little catch to this. And I don't want to say catch because God doesn't play games with us. There is a scripture. If you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 6, and I'm taking a little bit of prophetic liberty today to take it out of the context of spiritual warfare. Paul talks in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 6, says, to be ready to punish every disobedience when our obedience is made complete. Can I say that again? Being made ready to punish every disobedience when your obedience is completed. In other words, it's great to hear about the spirit of Phinehas and God wants to pour it out, but there is something that God wants us to do. Because this whole thing about Phinehas starts because the Israelites were disobeying God. But there was one man who stood up and did something. And God is giving us that spirit, and we are going to, that's a parallel with modern day, what we can do as things happen in our society. There is a parallel, but it calls for our obedience to be completed first. Are you hearing me? Tap someone and say, we need to obey. We need to fulfill every obedience. So we need to walk in obedience. And as we walk in obedience, our obedience will cause forth that power and that authority and that zeal that will enable us to punish every disobedience in the spirit realm. Principalities and powers. Forces of evil in wicked places. God gives us the authority to address them when we walk in obedience. That is mandatory. I know that's not a very pleasing word because we all like to receive a blessing word. But this is conditional. If when we complete our obedience, hallelujah, I just want you to know there is grace through Jesus to do anything that he has asked us to do. Second thing I just want to quickly say is that our fruitfulness will provoke Satan to jealousy. I want to be very careful when I say this because I want you to get it. I want it to sink. God is bringing us to a place of fruitfulness that will cause or provoke Satan to jealousy. And let me clarify that. The word I heard was Jezreel. If you don't catch it quickly, let me just give the prophetic statements and then I will talk about it. Where others failed to go in, where people, prophets, preachers, and leaders ahead of us or our friends or our own attempts, where in the past we had not been able to access, God is saying that in this season we will be able to access and go where others had stopped. Now I can clarify this. In 1 Kings chapter 18, we know the story of Elijah, right? You remember Elijah called for a drought, and the drought happened, and then he called for a flood, and then flood happened. But in 1 Kings chapter 18, we see that Elijah called for the rain, and the rain happened. And if you read, come to the last verse of 1 Kings chapter 18, you'll find that Elijah says to Ahab, the wicked king, run and go before the rain stops you. And he runs. It says Elijah tucked his cloak and he ran and he reached Jezreel before Ahab reached there. Okay? But the point I'm trying to make is, if you look at that last verse, it says Elijah ran all the way up to Jezreel, depending on what version you read. All the way up to Jezreel. All right? But if you continue on 1 Kings 19, verses 1, 2, and 3, in verse 3, you know, verse 1 and 2, Jezebel is all worked up. And then in verse 3, it says, Elijah turned back and went another way because he got afraid. He became afraid of Jezebel, and he turns around and goes back. He does not enter Jezreel. And then, for the sake, you know, you can read, it's a very fascinating story. Fast forward years later, chapters later, in 2 Kings chapter 9, you find there is a young man called Jehu. And Elijah had prophesied something, and then Elisha after him had prophesied something, but none of them had entered into Jezreel. Because Elijah had come, he did great feats and came up to Jezreel, and the gate of Jezreel, he stopped, he went back. But now comes a young man. His name is Jehu. And in 2 Kings chapter 9, it says, an unknown prophet, unnamed prophet, was asked to go and bring this word to a commander of the army called Jehu. Tell him that he will be the king and just anoint him and go. And we don't know the name of the prophet. So it was some small prophet from the company of prophets. And in verse 3, you'll see this prophet comes. He was given instruction. He says, anoint him, give him the prophetic word, and just go. Leave the door open and go. And then you'll see that's what happens in verse 10. This prophet comes and anoints him, anoints Jehu, and then he leaves the door open and runs out. So you'll wonder why the scripture says he left the door open. But here's the thing. I want to propose to you that the door that this no-name prophet had left open was the prophetic word that had been spoken over for many years. All the prophecies of the years past, that the judgment on Ahab and Jezebel and the good that God had intended for the house of Israel, all of those prophetic words of the years that had not come to pass, now the season was here. And so it was prophetically a door was open. And then if you read the chapter, you'll see Jehu gets out of that very door. I think it is in verse 16 of 2 Kings chapter 9. In verse 16 it says, so Jehu went and drove straight to Jezreel. And if you continue the story, you'll see that he goes in, he kills Jezebel, and you know he gets victory over the two kings. But the point is that he made it into Jezreel. Now, this wouldn't have been as exciting if you know that Ahab had a foul spirit and he wanted something that was on the other side of Jezreel. Now, close to his palace, there was another guy's vineyard called Naboth's vineyard. Everybody say Naboth's vineyard. Now, this vineyard was so good, it was so fruitful that Ahab the king coveted that. I'm coming to where you can make Satan envious and jealous with your fruitfulness. There was a vineyard. If you read that in 1 Kings 19, 20, 21, you'll see there's a vineyard called Naboth's vineyard. And Ahab the king wanted it, and Naboth refused to give it. But I want you to think about this. At a time of famine, when there was drought in the entire nation, there was one vineyard that was so fruitful. And if you read it, history says it had spring from under. It had a spring that watered it. And it had grapes and it had olives. So at a time of drought, there was a vineyard that was fruitful. And because of that, the wicked king wanted it. And somehow in this prophetic encounter, Elijah failed. He got scared of Jezebel and he ran. And then Elisha somehow didn't get there. But there was a generation that was ready. The door was open. The word had been spoken. And Jehu took the word of the Lord. He went through that open door. And he went past. And he got into Naboth's vineyard, which was on the other side of the gate of Jezreel. So I declare to you that gates that had stopped you, gates that where people had stopped previously that they could not enter for whatever reason, that in this season it is open for you. That there are vineyards that has grapes and olives that can be lush and green. There are vineyards that will be fruitful. There's a fruitfulness, and I'm not talking in the natural either. There's fruitfulness that is available in the Lord right at the time when people are drying up and there's drought and there's tears and sorrow. And it can be so fruitful that the enemy will be envying you. But God has anointed you to go take it. God has anointed you to go past the gate and get it. And I prophesy to you that gates are open, that we can go in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the last thing I want to say, we are coming into a season. And I don't want to say season because it kind of sounds general. 1 John chapter 1 verse 1. It says, that which we have seen with our eyes, that which we've heard with our ears, that which we have touched with our hands, that is what we proclaim to you. And I felt like the Spirit of the Lord was saying that there's coming a season, a time now in this new year where we will not be just talking theory. We will not just be, reading a book. We will not just be watching some preacher or some anointed person, but it'll be an experience for each one of us. And then we will be able to declare the word, and we will know it is because we have seen it with our own eyes. We've heard it with our own ears. We've experienced it. We've touched it. Hallelujah. And we want to receive that because that is what God's will is for us. Thank you, Lord.